Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. Our program is about to begin. أيها السيدات والسادة، سيبدأ البرنامج بعد قليل، لذا نرجو منكم التكرم بالجلوس في مقاعدكم.
Ladies and gentlemen, please silence your phones. Our program is about to begin.
Hello everyone. Good afternoon and welcome to day three of this WEP 2024. I believe this is the third keynote lecture and it's going to be an exciting one. It is about digital adventures titled Sustainable Management of Soil Health and Agriculture for Addressing Global Issues of the 21st Century by Professor Rattan Lal. This keynote will be moderated by Professor Jesse Poland. Before I introduce Professor Jesse, I'd like to give just a kind reminder to everybody to not forget their stuff here after you leave. We had a few incidents where people just lost their things and forgot them, so just be careful with that and take everything with you when you leave, and we'd appreciate it. And now, without further ado, Dr. Jesse Poland is a professor of plant breeding and genetics in the Center for Desert Agriculture at KAUST. He is appointed to the graduate faculty in plant science, where he serves as a major professor and committee member for students in plant genomics, breeding, and genetics. Dr. Poland is the acting director of the Feed the Future Innovation Lab for applied wheat genomics with focus on applying genomics tools to accelerate wheat breeding and develop climate-resilient wheat varieties throughout the world. Dr. Jesse is working on date palm breeding and genetics for the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Poland.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. I have the distinct pleasure to introduce Professor Lal today. He said to keep it short. He wanted to be introduced as the Distinguished Professor of Soil Science at The Ohio State University. I have a nice long thing. If I don't read it, I'll probably get fired. But just to summarize, he has a very long and distinguished career in innovative soil techniques that's impacting and benefiting the lives of millions around the world. I can simply summarize his academic achievements saying that he has more papers and more citations than I think all of us combined. And most notably, he has received the World Food Prize, which is recognized as the highest award, highest achievement in agriculture. And so a very brief summary of the phenomenal achievements of Dr. Lal. We had a wonderful discussion earlier, and so I'm looking forward to his presentation. Thank you.
Good evening. I feel very honored and privileged to be here. I must thank quite a few people who helped. Aga Safia, Sammy Vialba, Ian Young, Herbert Hurt, Samia, Jesse Poland, of course, and my guide and advisor and tour and philosopher friend, Connor Johnson, who really helped me last several days and also recommended me to be here. It's really an honor, privilege, and what I saw the facilities today make me feel that we come from rather humble place compared to the facilities and all the infrastructure and equipment, scientific, so obviously very high class university. I want to begin by stating the global issues. Population 8.05 billion and increasing 7.7 million per month, 92 per year, million. Per capita land, which is now 0.186 hectare globally, will decrease to 0.07 hectare for 30 countries next year. Soil degradation affects one-third of the land area of the Earth and increasing 5 to 10 million hectare per year. Per capita renewable water supply, less than 1,000 cubic meter for 30 countries and increasing the number to 58 by 2050, affecting 4 billion people. Atmospheric concentration of CO2 last year, 23, reached 424 parts per million, compared with 260 pre-industrial era. Energy use, tremendous. This country doesn't need any reference on that one. 38% of ice-free land of the earth used for agriculture, 5.2 billion hectare, 3.7 of which for raising livestock, 821 million people insecure food-wise. And this number has increased to 1,200 since the war. And the per capita global emission, globally about 5 tons of CO2. But in West Asia, such as here in the US, 17 metric tons of CO2 per year. And I am going to say something about wars and the political problem as affecting the soil health. And solution to these issues, from my point of view, in one way or the other, lies in sustainable management of soil and natural resources. And that's what I'm going to talk about. Let's begin with atmosphere. The carbon stock, gigaton, petagram, 10 to the 15 gram, billion tons, pre-agriculture era, 360, pre-industrial, 560. That means 200 came from agriculture alone over that period of time. At present, it's 880 gigaton. And this has come from land use change and agriculture emitting into the atmosphere to date, about 575 gigaton of carbon, compared to fossil fuel to date, 445. And the reason I mentioned land use, because you can do something about it. That's why it's very important to know that land use to date has been very important contributor to climate change. Now, how much can you continue emitting? It's very difficult to estimate, but I think from this country's point of view, 280 parts per million pre-industrial era, double that to make sure that we are still below 2 degrees centigrade global warming, minus 424, which I showed you we already reached, multiply by 2.13 gigaton per one part per million increase in the atmosphere. That number comes to 290 gigaton. We are burning right now 10 gigaton per year. That means 29 years, by 2050 at the most. There should be no carbon emission from fossil fuel. And that's very important message that should come out from this country and especially the next COP29 host, which is a neighboring country. The question is, how do you divide ethically, morally, that 290 gigaton amongst 8.05 billion people of the world. So there's an equitable distribution. I wish that political parties and those decision makers everywhere in the world pay a very good attention to this question. How do you divide 290? How do you make sure that we do not exceed 290 by 2050? Other issues to address to keep make sure that we keep below 2 degrees centigrade using no carbon energy, carbon capture and sequestration, recarbonization of the land, revisiting our lifestyle, making personal sacrifice, taking a personal responsibility for our action, and managing land and natural resources, dry land agriculture, soil inorganic carbon sequestration, returning some land of that 5.2 billion hectare back to nature, urban agriculture, and carbon farming. I'm going to try to address some of those issues as I can. But sequestering atmospheric carbon dioxide, first part, what are the options? Geologic sequestration, old oil wells, unminable coal mine, saline aquifer, cryogenic processes, chemical sequestration, chemical scrubbing, mineralization, oceanic sequestration, deep injection, iron fertilization, biotic sequestration, afforestation, reforestation, biofuel plantation, pedologic sequestration, soil, pedology, organic and inorganic, inorganic secondary carbonates, biochar, quite a few other issues. And of course, interaction among many of those combination that we can find what are the site-specific options. Geoengineering, some people think it's a very good solution, others think it's a problem with not in my backyard syndrome, because you do not know what may be the fate of that carbon. Different carbon stocks, we can have a gray carbon, which is atmospheric stock, I already mentioned. We have a red carbon, that is fossil fuel combustion. Every year, 1 gigaton goes back in the atmosphere. We have a green carbon, carbon in plant. Of course, the photosynthesis part. We have brown carbon, carbon in soil, which is organic carbon, which is brown carbon. And there is a good relation between atmosphere and that through respiration. And green carbon coming into humus through soil addition. Blue carbon. Today, I saw the mangrove region here. Oceanic area having blue carbon and of course white carbon. What's white carbon? Carbonates, bicarbonates, and the dry climate such as here, this part is very important and not being addressed, need to be addressed. And of course we got black carbon, the soot, which goes in the atmosphere, and the interaction between them. So understanding which carbon can help us minimize the carbon stock in the atmosphere is very critical. Similar to carbon, there are different kinds of water. We have water resources, blue water, that's open water, rivers, groundwater, ocean, lakes, so forth. We got gray and black water, which is the urban water, which has been used. We got green water, the water that the plants absorb from soil, on which all life depends. And of course, how can we convert blue into green? And of course, gray-black, which is the urban water, also back to green, recycling, which in a country such as this is very critical. So that we can link the water part to the carbon part, which we just... And there's another water called virtual water, the water which is contained in the commodity that you produce, that you sell, that you transport, that you export. You carry water with it. And that water has to be accounted for, especially in an area where water is a very limiting factor. In terms of the pedologic sequestration, here is a good example, good picture. We got the upper part of the soil horizon, which has the organic carbon, that's why it's black. And in a drier climate, such as here, the lower part, which is white carbon, inorganic carbonates and bicarbonates, a very significant part, two carbon components. So when I talk carbon sequestration, it's both organic and inorganic. Now, the global soil carbon pool, the other day we discussed mapping work which is being done here, 30 centimeter depth, that's a common one. So global soil organic carbon, 704, inorganic carbon, now 234, to 1 meter depth is minimum. I want to repeat that. 1 meter depth measurement is minimum. 1500, 722 total. So 2 meter, 3 meter, and often as much as 6,000 gigaton of carbon in soils of the world to 3 meter depth. Imagine plants contain 620, one-tenth, and atmosphere contains 880. So small change in the soil carbon stock can make a big change in the atmosphere. And this is something very important to remember. A small change can overwhelm the atmosphere. And on the other hand, it's such a large stock, we cannot ignore, and it's important to manage. Global dry land, very important part. And you are heart of the global dry land. At present, 41% of the area. And this area is going to become 50% by 2100. It's expanding. And it has a tremendous capacity to soak carbon, which is one of the things that I would like to talk to you about today. Now, population. I'm going to give an example of the cities from the region. 1950, Dubai was 0.02 million. 2030, 5.2 million. The increasing factor, Jeddah, gone up by 42 times. Khartoum, 40 times. Kuwait, 46 times. Mecca, 14 times. And Riyadh, 200 times. Rapid urbanization, water consumption requirement, food. Why do I mention food? Because we have to have some way to able to recycle gray and black water. Remember the gray-black water to produce fresh food within the city limits. To bring from outside is practically not a viable option. Planning city, very rapidly growing in here. That planning will be completely incomplete and obsolete within the next 10 years if the food production is not part of that planning process within the city limits. So urban agriculture, one way or the other, very important. And the reason for that is it takes 40,000 hectares to provide accommodation to 1 million people. And the infrastructure, annual increase of 92 million require 4 million hectares globally. Sometime agricultural prime land going under urbanization. By 2025, next year, there'll be 37 cities in the world, more than 10 million people. These are called mega city. A mega city of 10 million people requires 6,000 tons of food per day. That is why planning cities in a dry climate such as here and in the Western United States, planning without food production within city limit, at least 10%, 20%, is absolutely necessary. And the vertical farms is one option, coming up some in Hong Kong, Singapore, also in Chicago, is something that research done at this university. I would like to see, if I come back next time in a few years, I hope, that there will be something going along those lines because of many benefits. Year-round produce, no loss due to extreme weather, low fossil fuel consumption, low pesticide use, less water use, safe, low wastage, no soil degradation. You can think about many things. Logistics, very important part. Now, there are two types of soil carbon. I mentioned I'm now changing the subject to soil carbon, organic and inorganic. In this climate, inorganic is the most important part. In humid climate where I come from, Ohio, organic is the most important part. Organic carbon is a living biomass, undecomposed biomass, decomposed. The decomposed can be protected, unprotected, dissolved organic carbon, particulate organic. So if you are doing mapping and analysis, do not forget fractionation. Plan now. The inorganic carbon, which I think should be done, it is two types, pedogenic and lithogenic. Lithogenic carbon, the one come from rocks. Pedogenic is which is being formed by pedological processes. The formation of pedological processes in soil as carbonates and bicarbonates is a sequestration process. I was asking today to Dean Young whether you have facility to evaluate the possibility of rate of formation of pedogenic carbonates, and which I was very pleased to see that he does have that. And of course, there's a relationship between the two. When the decomposition happens, CO2 evolved, eventually become pedogenic carbonates. And the chemical reaction that happens in soil over a long period of time, called URI reactions, which in detail looks like combining CO2 leading to formation of carbonic acid, eventually formation of carbonates. Evaluating this overall reaction in this climate will provide a very good thesis research to many students, which we need to do, and try to find out how much carbon can be sequestered by this process, because it's a much longer residence time. This is how the secondary carbonates will look like. The kind of whitish material, and can be evaluated, quantified. This is another example. They can be sheet-like material or granules in soil. And today we were looking at one of the profile. I didn't see these granules, but certainly washing the profile, we might be able to see how some of these things look like, but the rate of sequestration research need to be done here. Amongst all things of carbon sequestration, land, we human using 40% of the land area, only one of the species out of several million is rather being greedy. And I think we should be thinking about how to return some land and water that we had taken from nature back to nature. And I'll explain that how. So by 2100, in my guess, and not many people agree with me that, that's normal, we must return half of the current land under agriculture now back to nature, half of the land. There are many people, many international development organizations that will say just the opposite. In fact, I have read many times, we need 500 million more hectares by 2050. Let's cut Amazon. Let's cut Sumatra. Absolutely not. Use what you have properly, judiciously, prudently. That's the only way I know development organizations think that's crazy, but here is a timetable which I would suggest on a global scale, which means going back to the United Nations, which may not agree with it, or to the World Bank, or to the other organization, and convince them that the fertilizer use right now, 200 million ton with the efficiency in China and India, hardly 25%, improve the efficiency. That's where you need soil health, cut the rate down. By 2100, there is no reason to have more than 50 million tons, as long as the efficiency goes up. Irrigation area, we have 350 million hectare now. If we use drip irrigation, not flooding, not furrow, not sprinkler, those are obsolete. In a climate like this, I'll be thinking about vapor irrigation, where vapors condense on the roots, easy to transport. So the area should go up, but the amount of cropland area can be decreased from 1,500 to 750, exactly half. Conservation agriculture, which right now is 210 million hectare. All the cropland area should be under conservation agriculture, especially in this climate. And grazing land, right now 3,700 million hectare. No reason to have more than 1,500. I'm not talking about no cattle, absolutely not. Using land properly and using food properly. Now, water use 3,150 kilometer cube for irrigation. In a climate like this, sprinkler, flood, furrow, forget it. Don't even think about it. Either drip and sub-drip or even vapor. The volume of water used for irrigation has to decrease while the efficiency of irrigation goes up. But at the same time, the crop yield goes up double than what it is now. Therefore, we are producing more from less. Less land, less water, less fertilizer. It does not say no. It's not no organic. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about efficient use of all the inputs. Now, desert agriculture, a very important topic for this climate. Agriculture in the Sahara, I have recently seen in Algeria and in Morocco and a few other countries, I've been very impressed what can be done. In fact, I'm going to share a few slides and pictures with you. Here it is, dry land agriculture in China. Rainfall 200 millimeter. Notice gravel mulch, which is permanent with drip irrigation. Sunflower, same kind of thing. Wheat, a mulch which is put there for next 25 years. Drip irrigation on a permanent basis. Save water, produce excellent in a rainfall of 200 millimeter per year. This is dryland agriculture in Algeria, potatoes. In the middle of the Sahara, tomatoes under greenhouse structures. Again, greenhouse structure under tomato cultivation. Export for Europe, potatoes. You could pull them out by hand because this is sand. An excellent crop. So Sahara desert agriculture is really something which is important for the future, but there are challenges. Restoring soil health, very important, physical, chemical, biological, ecological, balancing plant nutrients, micro and micro, increasing water use efficiency, promoting system thinking so that we have a holistic approach, and establishing native crop species as much as possible. Do not try to bring anything from elsewhere, as we are talking about. This is very important hypothesis, multiple resource limitation in global dry lands. Multiple, and not just water. Yes, I can put water first, but don't forget carbon, nitrogen, phosphorus, micronutrients, everything together. That is what explain the response function, what we call multiple resource limitation strategy. Now, finally, I want to come to carbon farming. What does carbon farming mean? Growing carbon as a commodity, like you grow potato or wheat or barley, or chicken or poultry or whatever else, that you can get income from. That's a commodity. Carbon growing soil as a source of income. That's what we want to call by. How much income? I calculated $200 per ton of carbon. That come to $50 per ton of credit. $50 per ton of credit. So if you can sequester one credit of carbon, certified, organic or inorganic, you should be paid $50. And this way, farmer got income from, and this is, you will do this, and you can be paid. Now, for doing that, I was very pleased to see that chairman of the COP28 in Dubai made an announcement, we will donate $200 million. I was very grateful to hear that statement. But I was also astonished. 200 million coming from an oil-rich country. What we need is 550 billion to pay small landholder of the world. And there are 500 million of them. If you take large-scale farmer like North America and Europe, you need another 50 billion. And there are 100 million farmers of those. Total to make agriculture a solution to climate change requires $100 billion per year. And oil exporting country has a responsibility toward that. Moral responsibility, ethical responsibility. Not 200 million. I'm sorry to hear that. That is what the price is. That is how you convince farmer, do it. And we are behind you. We assure you that you will not suffer. That's how it will happen. Not otherwise. Private sector can play an important role, very important role, by investment in many things. And I think we should make sure that the private sector get involved. Finally, I'm not going to make name of any country. I'm not a politician. In fact, I have never voted in my life, and I do not plan to. But a war has three parties. Three parties. There are two parties, whether they are countries or there are communities fighting with one another. And the third party is land on which they fight. whether the tanks come from one party or the other? Does one tank crush soil less than the other does? Does anybody talk about wildlife, soil degradation, pollution, contamination? That will go on for decades. Did you know Agent Orange used in Vietnam? The war ended in 1960s. Still, birth defects in children and human and in wildlife. Water still contaminated. So somewhere, just like people, nature, soil, water, air, biodiversity is also suffering. That the third party nobody talks about. I do not know why religious leader Pope Francis and other, why UN leader keep quiet about it, why the third party has no spokesperson. And it is that third party which is suffering silently, which will affect humanity and nature for decades to come. And nobody talks about it. I call on those who are fighting, and I don't care why they are fighting, stop it. It's a crime against nature. It's unforgivable. Unforgivable. Whether missiles are fired because of hatred or fear, both people and soil suffer. War changes soil from a womb for a terrestrial life into a tomb for all dead. And war turns bones of soil and life into bandage of slavery and death. Civilized world should not have war. I doesn't care why. War nears the living, but it encourages humanity to worship the dead. Therefore, rights of soil is very important. Soil is a living entity. Soil is the basis of all terrestrial life. There can be no life without soil. No life without soil. We talk about extinct bald eagle. We talk about extinct panda. We talk about extinct monarch butterfly. Do you know there are extinct soil? Do you know there are endangered soil? We are degrading them every day. We are polluting them. We are contaminating them. We are ruining them. They must have rights. So just as there are universal rights of humans and rights of animals, there must also be rights of soil. Social scientists in this country, in this university, and anywhere else, legal scientists should think about that. And being the essence of all life, soil must also have rights. And I've written an article on that topic. I don't think anybody thinks it's important, but soil must have rights. And finally, if I were to plot a graph of security, whether it's a political, economic, social, environmental on one side, and it is a human, social, national, regional, international, global on the other side, in the center of this graph is the most critical factor which we all ignore, soil and its health and its management. And the management of this very simple thing, which is taken for granted everybody. Nobody calls soil, everybody calls dirt. Are you a dirt scientist? No, I'm a soil scientist. And it is this on which its health depends, the food security, water security, energy security, climate security, health and nutritional security, environment security, political security, national security, and global peace and harmony. When the soils are degraded, there will be no peace and harmony. You fight for that soil. That has been the case throughout the human history. And we part have to recognize that. Finally, I would like to leave a message. I've been watching my 46 seconds left out of 30 minutes. I want to make a final statement about famines and wars. 1,200 million people hungry. And their numbers increasing by the day. Famine and wars are man-made tragedies. We produce enough food now to feed 10 million people. Food is not accessible when the war is going on, or when the people do not have money. to buy when the food is not distributed. That's the problem. Therefore, we must make wars, famine, and mass starvation politically intolerable, morally toxic, ethically unthinkable, and humanly unacceptable. Why and how? Through promoting peace, harmony, and brotherhood. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lal. Wonderful perspective. I always appreciate the perspective of realizing how much carbon is stored and how much potential in agriculture. And then also this very important perspective on what we do to our soils and how we need to live off of the soils. I'm also reminded to tell a true soil scientist, you just tell them that it's dirt. And if they, you know, if they get aggressive, then you know they're a true soil scientist. You never want to call it dirt. It's a living organism. So I'll open up to questions. There's two microphones here. If you would come down and speak into the microphone so we can hear your questions. We'll take questions from anyone now. Don't be shy, come right up. Yes, go ahead.
First of all, thank you for the very interesting presentation and topic. This is really insightful. I wanted to clarify one point. You mentioned as an example UAE, which has bought a budget of 200 millions, right, for carbon capture. And you mentioned that because that oil-producing countries should even have bigger responsibility towards this goal. Is this correct, or I misunderstood the point that you have made?
Can you tell me what he asked? Talked about carbon capture.
Just to summarize the question, you were saying that the responsibility of UAE or other countries to support these carbon capture initiatives.
Making sure I understood right, that he made the point that countries that have their economy depending on oil should participate more into carbon capture.
Well, all countries have responsibility. Each of us is a culprit as well as a perpetrator and a victim. We are both culprit and victim together. So each one of us has a responsibility. But somebody who has a potential to contribute is obviously the country which have money. And so oil exporting companies have done something that has eventually led to the so-called global warming issue. So they should do their part. And the other should also contribute. And the amount which I was mentioning, Paris Accord also asked 100 billion per year. But they said 100 billion for everybody. I calculate 100 billion only for agriculture. Because agriculture is really the only industry which can withdraw CO2 from the atmosphere. So to expect farmers to do things which may be a risk to reduce production, we should assure them that their cost of doing business, consumer will pay for it. And I calculated this value on the basic amount of crop residue, what it could bring to them if they were to sell it, water required to produce extra carbon in soil, additional nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, nutrient, because residue has a very bad CN ratio, humus has a lower, so I added all those prices into it. That is what that price was. I don't think farmer will invest $50 to do something if the consumer does not want to support it. Do not expect it to happen. And land is the only sink, I'm talking about land-based sink, which has many co-benefits. We have lost, remember I gave a figure, 570 gigaton since agriculture began. Even if we put half of that back, it has a tremendous impact, positive, in mitigating the climate change. So if we can turn the agriculture as a solution reward farmer, make legal possibilities, Soil Health Act, for example, to pay them. I think by 2100, we will have a downward trend and warming will not go more than 1.5 degrees centigrade. I believe in it. I have scientific data, but not without paying farmers. Don't expect them to do it without it.
I understand now. You are talking about like making change in a like systematic level, not just ask people to do it like individually. So thank you. It's clear. I think.
Good. Good. Thank you. Other questions?
Okay. Yeah, great talk. Very comprehensive. I think one thing that should be really clear, I mean, in this setting of this country, is that dry lands have a huge perspective, actually, in carbon sequestration. And this is not so much in organic carbon, but in inorganic carbon sequestration. And I think the Saudi Greening Initiative is a fantastic possibility, actually, to make this happen. So that means there is a responsibility of taking care of the country, but if you can couple that with the right plants, and you also need the right microbes to do that, then you can actually have a tremendous amount of carbon that can be sequestered in this country alone.
Yeah.
Now, as you said, 40% of all countries on terrestrial surface are basically dry lands. That means we have a lot of countries that are not oil producing. That means they don't have income, right? So where does the money come from? What I was missing from your talk is actually the carbon credits. Because if you think that a carbon credit system can be initiated, then of course a lot of the poor countries, which do not have the money, could actually do also carbon farming. And that means the local farmers would have an income to do that, which they don't have right now. What do you think about that?
It's a very good question, and I purposely did not use the word carbon credit. And the reason for this is go back to Chicago Climate Exchange. Chicago Climate Exchange started 2000 at $1 a credit. By 2006, it went to $6 a credit. I think there were 6,000 or something, number I forgot, and quite a few million acres were enrolled under that program. And then what happened? Market crashed from $6 to 20 cents a credit. Why did it crash? Demand and supply. There was a lot of supply. All the farmers in the US were willing to sign up, and many of them did. But who was buying it? And when it crashed, who reached? Who got rich? The traders. If you go to farmers now, anywhere in the US, and say, I want to buy from you carbon credit, I don't know that many are willing to talk to you. Trust. As long as no regulation exists to have demand and supply marketing forces, so-called by economists, met, 20 cents a credit is a joke. You can't get a cup of coffee with it. Even putting sugar is cost more than that. So I am not in favor of credit until the market forces are properly defined by legislation. Until then, the only way to encourage farmers to do is through what we call payment for ecosystem services. The Green Deal in Europe is based on that. They are paying 35 euro, which happened to come equal to almost $50. I think we have to make sure that farmers are not ripped off again. Otherwise, they will never trust anybody. And one more problem. Carbon credit, also people say, we want to make sure that we monitor each and every acre properly so we know what we are paying for. The cost of one sample analysis after the sample you've taken is $20. Let's say you are a farmer with 10 acres and your agent wants to sample that 10 acre, 10 points everywhere to 1 meter depth, and you have 200 samples. 200 times 20 is $4,000. Who's going to pay that out of that $50? That is a ripoff. So that clause that we must make measurement, monitoring, and verification before we pay is not a pro-farmer argument. I'm sorry to say that. So what should we do? You know, we had a CRP program, Conservation Reserve Program. It came with Farm Bill 1987. And Farm Bill said, if you set aside highly erodible land, which they defined so much percent, map and everything, we will compensate you as much as you would have earned by growing corn or soybean in it. Did we go and monitor runoff and erosion with a flume from every acre? No. We took satellite picture. And if the land was set aside, pay. This is what we got to do now. Take a satellite picture. If they are growing perennial, if they have a cover crop, if they have mulch, pay. How much? Ohio has 8 experiment stations where the data exists. You can have a local model. But don't put monkey wrenches to get money from the farmer for evaluation of soil property. Once in a while, yes, you go and validate it, but I'm not in favor of that. And this is the reason. I'm a pro-agriculture, I'm a pro-farmer, I'm a pro-nature. I'm not a pro-trader. I never will be.
Okay, next question here.
Thank you so much for an interesting talk. As Bill McDonough said, we move at the speed of trust, right? And I see your concluding statements very beautifully written and said, but in the current world that where we're living in, there's so much disgrace and so much with the current war going on, and when we see how even international organizations cannot enforce actions in real life, how do we bring trust again? How do we see our way forward? If global organizations cannot act in such clear situations to save human lives, how are we gonna save soil? So that's question number one.
Just to repeat and make sure we get the question right, is just to rephrase, you're saying it, with this element of trust between organizations, between farmers, between governments, in the absence of that, or how do you enact such a system in this sort of real world where you have this element of distrust?
I think this is where the payment for ecosystem services to begin with. Eventually, I think I agree market will have to take place so that it's generating money. But the initial 3 to 5 year period, for example, I would draw a graph. Initial 3 to 5, there is no response or a negative response to change of technology. That critical period, farmers should be assured they'll be paid a certain amount. Once that thing goes on, after that period is over, market forces are developed. There's a system to make payment through simple system. So I think that initial period is very critical, in which that trust must be developed. Right now, there is none. I'm sorry.
Yeah, thank you. My second question is, you mentioned that we need to return land to nature, and also the idea of utilizing the opportunities to use dry lands for agriculture, desert agriculture, right? How do we find that delicate balance between the two? Giving the global pressure and population and demand.
how you see the way to feed the world if you want to spare the land. Mm-hmm. That's the question, because I was saying. Right now, the rough estimate is that 30% of the grains we produce, 3.2 billion tons, 1.2 billion tons are wasted. 1.2 billion tons of grains produced are wasted, even in the United States. Secretary Vilsack has agreed 30% waste is normal. Fresh produce waste is even more. So first of all, I would like to hope, it's not easy to cut down the waste, but I hope we can reduce the waste. Second, many countries, especially Africa, Andean region, Caribbean, South Asia, productivity can be easily doubled or tripled through better policy. The Green Revolution in Africa did not happen because policies are not pro-agriculture. So if we can improve the policies, so agriculture can be improved. So rather than cutting more forest, productivity from the existing land can go up. So it will have to be at a level where we take responsibility that we do want to save land for. So I think we, as I mentioned, we produce enough food already to feed 10 billion people. And I'm not saying that nobody should eat meat, but meatless Monday is not a bad idea. So once in a while, cut down rather than eating two times meat, if you ate one time, I realized my hair got gray because I don't eat meat. So a small price to pay.
Okay.
Beautiful. Thank you so much.
I've got a big warning here that we're out of time, but we're going to take one last question, except you have as much time as you want, so go ahead.
All right. Thank you for having me for the last question. I really thank you for this very interesting talk. Very, very interesting perspective, and I really, before that, would like to thank you for coming all the way to here, Kaos, and we would like to welcome you here. Just out of curiosity, when you calculated the estimated income that farmer can generate from the carbon they could sequester, did you consider the CO2 emissions possibly that can be generated from the transportation and the processing of their products?
So,
have you subtracted the CO2 just from transportation and processing?
Just to summarize, in your calculations of farmer potential to capture and sequester more carbon, does that take into account the entire system, which might include transport, you know?
Oh, I see what you mean, yeah. Is it a gross or net carbon sequestration? That's what you're saying?
Yep.
Yeah. Well, if you send me an email, I'll send you a paper which I give how much a carbon cost of nitrogen fertilizer, potassium fertilizer, how much the carbon cost of plowing, how much the carbon cost of pumping irrigation water or applying herbicides. So eventually we must really calculate net, take all the carbon cost of doing business, so you are then paid the price on net gain, which makes it more difficult if it was a market-based system to begin with. So yes, you are right. We must calculate net, which means also reducing losses. Nitrogen, for example, is 2 kilograms of carbon per kilogram of nitrogen from fossil fuel as a source of energy. So if you can improve the efficiency, rather than 20%, it's 80%. You save carbon, you at the same time save fertilizer use. But I wish I could go into more detail on what a modern agriculture should look like, and it should have a plant that we can communicate to. It should have more responsive to input. The efficiency use is better. So the slogan should be produce more from less, so that net carbon sequestration is higher.
All right, thank you.
Okay, good, thank you. Oh, we've got some special something for you. That's very nice. So I'd just like to thank you all again for joining, and Thank you to Professor for an outstanding talk and a very important perspective for us today. And so thanks again for coming all this way and joining us here at Coast.
Thank you so much. It's very nice. Wow. Thank you.
We're supposed to stand here in the middle.
Oh.